Commissioner Evans, both, neither.
But, well, basically, you know, we started looking at, me and Ms. Evans talked about things, and justice reform came up. And so we started looking at numbers, and, we basically looked at our jail, well, it came about two different reasons. She looked at it for different reasons than I looked at it for. We got together, and, you know, you look at the budget, the sheriff budget of 18 million roughly, is a big part of our budget, total budget. And so you start looking at what the budget entails, and $8-9 million of it is jail. So we started looking at, you know, things that reform the criminal justice system. And, you know, when we started this, it was about summer 15, and we had over 700 people in jail on a consistent basis. And so you're looking at roughly 580 people per 100,000 if you count Hamilton County and our statistics. And statewide was 340 per 100,000, and nationalwide was 240 per 100,000. So we're way over on the numbers. So anyway, we started talking about that. So we got together with the judges and the sheriff and other criminal justice, the DA and solicitor and all, everybody got together and started talking about things. And out of that came the first accountability court that Judge Timmons and Judge Coward started, which was the drug, mental health, and veterans court for the Superior Court system. We've also added, since that time, we've also added the DUI court for the state court system. We've gotten a software program that has not been implemented, but should be implemented in the next 15 to 16 months. This is going to integrate all the courts together. And the sheriff is on board. We're going to the software program to integrate the sheriff's office with the court system, which I think is going to be a tremendous asset when it's all said and done. Instead of using four different systems we're using now, we're going to have one. I mean, they're all the same groups, they're all the same integrated system. And so it's going to work out, I think, really well. We've also hired two positions for the state court. One was a assistant to Judge Golden, and the other was a pre-trial, post-trial coordinator to try to help get some people that are sitting in jail for different reasons out of equipment. If you heard the sheriff yesterday, instead of 700 people in jail, I just remember he's averaged about 625. So, I don't know if we can count that to this or anything we've done so far, but we do have less people in jail today than we do summer of 15. And hopefully this will continue to drop. You know, right now we're still using four buildings, and you got to have the manpower to watch four different buildings with our inmates. If we could drop one building, it would be significant. I'd love to get to where, like the sheriff said yesterday, where we end up just using pods C and D, which are the two newest pods they built. And that would cut our need for personnel down drastically. Instead of watching four buildings, we're only watching two. So that's my end of it. Ms. Evans in, you know, we've also got a day reporting center light, DRC light, that's coming for the Superior Court system, and we've got a potential to do something kind of unique for the state court system to kind of tie into that program. So that's the things we're still working on. At this point, I think we've done a lot. We've got to get the software implemented, DRC light, get it situated and set up. Talk about implementing a day reporting center for the state court. I'm not sure if we're quite there yet, but we're getting closer there. And then you get, then we have to sit back and kind of see where we are and what happens to the inmate population and the criminal system itself. And hopefully it's it'll move a little smoother and faster going through the system. As the sheriff said yesterday, out of the 625 people he's got in jail, 500 of them roughly are waiting on some kind of court date. So it's not necessarily people been sentenced and they're waiting, you know, you got a lot of people who've been sentenced to jail, These people are just waiting for a trial, waiting for, you know, some kind of court date to either get out or whatever.
He is also hot on that public defender and these continuances.
Yes.
Keep dragging this thing on.
That's something that's got to be looked into, Mark.
What I was going to ask was, what's our position there, and are we going to jump in and do something?
I think it really is something the sheriff is going to have to work on with his communication with the public defender's office to see if he can do some things to expedite those cases.
But hopefully the software program we're putting in will help some with that issue too.
It's nothing else than bringing the lights.
Yeah. I mean, I think this software, once we get it implemented in roughly 15 months, hopefully it's going to speed things up drastically, and everybody will have a lot more information than they have.
Okay, I want to just thank you and Commissioner Evans. There's something that y'all have, and really just took it straight to it. I mean, quick turnaround. And I think I can honestly say, not comparing sheriffs or whatever, but what I heard yesterday was a sheriff that really wants to have anybody jailed too. That's going to make every effort to give them something productive to do instead of just taking them straight.
He's working on the work release program. People that need to be in jail, I want them to be there. If they committed a murder, or they committed, you know, they've gone out and child abuse and these issues, those people need to be in jail. The person that doesn't have $400 fine because they have a suspended license, that person really need to be in jail because they don't have $400 to pay for the bail? I mean, it's
not at cost.
Not at cost of $45 a day to us. 10 days and we're in the hole.
Yeah.
I mean, that stuff kind of makes, and that's where we are. You know, these people that, you know, maybe not cannot make bail for some reason, but they're not a menace to society. It's not a, in my opinion, a threat to society, they don't need to be in jail. It's another tool. And I guess the thing is, when we started looking at this, you know, there's no silver bullet. You can't say, well, let's do this and they'll take care of the problem. It's all these programs that are this and that, and this takes care of this 10 people, and this over here takes care of 25 people, and this over here takes care of 100 people. And then you start looking at it, you got to put all the pieces together, and then you start, you know, your funnel comes down instead of just all these people waiting in jail for trial. You know, maybe you got 250 people in jail waiting on trial. You know, that's, or waiting for a court date. So if we can get to that point, then our inmates are going to be a lot less, and it's going to cost us a lot less to run the jail. But that's kind of where we are. Plus, the benefits to society, which is what Ms. Evans started looking at originally, was just the benefits of having people, you know, rehabilitated. You know, if you got, you know, the drug court, that's what the drug courts and the accountability courts are for, you know, is to cut out our recidivism rate. And so if you take 100 people and go through it, and 60% of them pass, and go through and graduate through the system, that's 60 people that over a 2-year period, hopefully won't be in the same boat 18 months, 2 years down the road where they were, where people that don't go through that, that's what you're going to have. You're going to have all those people back in jail. You know, I think I heard one time 85% of people that are sitting in Lowndes County Jail have already been in Lowndes County Jail. That's crazy. I heard that. I said, there's no possible way that could be. 85% of them have already been there once. Okay.
We
got a problem. And that's where we are with that. So I don't mean, unless you have any questions. Sir? So we're kind of in a situation now. We just want to get everything put in place over the next 2 years and kind of see how everything's playing out and then make some adjustments and see what else we need to do.
And I think the DRC would be as soon as we work on some information.
They'll give me the information on.
Well, the DRC likes coming. It's gonna be here, April, May.
They were to give me back information about who these individuals were, so we could contact them to contract for that portion that would be related to our accountability. I can't do the budget on that until I know what those numbers are.
But when you just give your representative, they can help us get the money transferred to somewhere else.
Yeah, they moved the VRC light, was not very productive, the movement to Lowndes County, so.
Well, I know y'all are both so humble, you don't want or you blush when people pass on the back, and we all contribute, I know, and but y'all too, I mean, it's been an honor to watch y'all work together and see y'all's accomplishments related to this. I know there's a lot of other people involved.
Well, I think the key to success, and maybe we can all learn from this, but the key is the success of the implementation of the accountability corps comes back to really two commissioners that really had two different, totally different interests in the process. Ms. Evans' interest was primarily in trying to get the individuals out of jail, get them back to where they can be productive citizens for their families, so they can fulfill those type of obligations. Mr. Griner's issue was, let's look to see if we can reduce financially, can we reduce the cost of what has happened for us to house these inmates. So when you bring those two interests together and they begin to realize that they really two are intertwined, it makes it much easier for something like this to get off the ground and for it to gain support. It's almost impossible for me to sit here and argue with the two of you on the efforts that you're putting into this, because you're really working extremely hard with it. Now, I feel like that I wouldn't be responsible from my standpoint as the chairman to say, I'm trying to watch it back up and just kind of watch it as it takes place, because there's going to come a time, even though we're getting some funding currently to get the accountability court started, there's going to be a greater demand on the budget for Lowndes County to continue to support these. I spoke to one of the judges here a while back, and when we were talking about one of the accountability courts, I said, you know, the citizens that participate in the accountability courts, they're there because it requires accountability. From my standpoint, I'm also requiring accountability on the accountability courts. So we're going to be needing to make sure that we're able to get the feedback that all of the needs that both of these two commissioners are looking for, the social aspect and the judiciary responsibility standpoint, that all of those needs are being met, and then are we successful, and is it worth Lowndes County and the citizens then to justify putting revenue into this program to continue to grow it? So
I hope we see both sides are successful.
I hope you do. I mean, I wish the whole thing total and complete success, but again, there's going to have to be a gauge of that success. We can't just say, well, yeah, we're doing a lot on this side, but we're not doing anything over there, and so now it's costing the taxpayers of Lowndes County more and more money. Even though we've lowered the jail cost, we've increased cost over here just to keep them out of jail. So, you know, we've got to look at the big picture, and as that data begins to come in, we'll have a better idea of it. So, again, I commend both of you for the great work. Ms. Evans has been working on this for years, in a sense, and it took the opportunity for another commissioner that wanted to also get something accomplished on the other end for this to come together. And so again, I commend you for working together.